Heavenly Father, we want to bow before the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Father, this day is so supremely important, not because it's just another Sunday, but Father, we are celebrating this remarkable reality that Jesus Christ rose from the grave. And because of him, we can have hope, we can have meaning, we can have a real relationship with you. I ask that your Spirit would take your word and apply this word to each of our lives. And I pray for all of us who are here, Father. Some of us are Christians. We have given our life to the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, I pray that today we would leave here more amazed at the splendor and majesty of our Savior. And for those of us, Father, maybe there are some here today who have wandered from the faith. I pray that they would understand that you are a good, loving Father and that you will welcome them home. And for those who are here this morning who have not yet responded to the Lord Jesus Christ, we ask, Lord, that today would be that day. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. The reality is that all of us have, and all of us are even right now, responding to the Lord Jesus Christ. All of us are. Now, some of you might say, oh, no, I'm not. I'm still skeptical and I'm not responding. Well, that in and of itself is a response. And I pray today that as we look at the text we're going to look at, actually several texts, that today each of us would understand we must respond. And we are going to look at a text that for some of you, it's like, oh, yeah, you know what? It's like the Alamo, the story of the Alamo. If you're from San Antonio, raise your hand. Okay, yes, the story of the Alamo. And sadly, a lot of times Christians, or when we hear it, it's like, oh yeah, I know that story. This story is the most remarkable story in human history. And if it's true, it means everything. If it's not true, it means nothing. We're going to be looking today at first this remarkable story in Matthew 28 verses 1 through 10. If you would please turn there. Jesus has died at this point, and he has been buried. We went over this on our Good Friday service, and we saw that there's no doubt he's been crucified, he's been killed, he's dead. And his followers believe that all hope is lost. They never saw this coming. But we read this in Matthew 28. Now, after the Sabbath, toward the dawn of the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to see the tomb. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothes as white as snow. Now, we're going to break things down just a little bit for explanation purposes. For the Jewish people, the Sabbath officially ends with sundown on Saturday. This is Sunday. It's around dawn. And I want you to notice, please pay attention, particularly if you're skeptical. If you're here today and you're a skeptic, I really want you to pay attention to this. I want you to notice who it is that goes to the tomb and what happens afterwards. You'll understand in a bit, okay? Believe it or not, it's very important who it is and what happens. Now, these Marys are there, and we know that one is Mary, the mother of James, and the other is the other Mary. She and Mary Magdalene go to the tomb, and it says they went to see the tomb. Now, we know from Luke's gospel they came to finish anointing his body for burial. They do this out of love and devotion. They believe he's dead. He's gone, unjustly killed. His story is over. Yet still they love, and this is one last act of devotion. And then everything changes. It's a remarkable scene. There's a great earthquake. It's the second earthquake associated with Jesus' death. The first earthquake happened when he gave up his spirit and died on the cross. But now there is a second, and this earthquake is not the only traumatic thing that happens. An angel descends from heaven and rolls away the stone that's covering the tomb. He's holy, majestic, he's brilliant. The scripture says his appearance is like lightning, his clothing as white as snow. And what we get here from the Greek, the words that are used to describe the angel, his appearance was like lightning. In other words, it's very difficult to describe what he's seeing or what was seen. There's no framework for adequately describing what he looks like. So it's a remarkable event, but it's also traumatic. If you'll notice the response of the guards, it terrifies them. It says in verse 4, and for fear of him, the angel, the guards trembled and became like dead men. Now, these are Roman soldiers, guards. These are hard men. They're not afraid of anything. But what they encounter, or rather who they encounter, they recognize they're powerless. And again, no framework for this. And it says they are paralyzed. And what's interesting is that they're paralyzed with fear. And what's interesting is in the Greek, the wording suggests that they're paralyzed with fear and they literally pass out unconscious. Traumatized. Now the women are scared. They're scared and they're afraid, but they don't pass out. And the angel says to them, do not be afraid. Do not be afraid. Now, it's very common when we look at Scripture, if you were to walk through Genesis all the way through Revelation, anytime someone encounters an angel of the Lord, they're traumatized. It's no small thing. So their response is to be expected, and they're told, do not be afraid. And then in verses 5 and 6, the angel said to the women, do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. And here is this remarkable claim. He is not here, for he has risen as he said. See the place where he lay. Just come see for yourself. I know you're looking for Jesus, but he's not here. Now, if you walk through the Gospels, you will see over and over Jesus telling his disciples and saying that he has come to die. Jesus came to die. And there are some who have this theory that Jesus was a well-intended religious leader. He didn't mean to, and you know, he was just trying to do good, and it just didn't work out, and it ended up with him dying on a cross, and we Christians are all just misguided because that's not why he came. False. The Gospels make it very clear. Jesus, in his own words, says many, many times that he came to die. That's why he came. He came for you and he came for me. So the angel says, I know you're looking for him, but he's not here. Because Jesus also said the grave would not hold him down, that he would rise again. So come see for yourself. The place is empty. So again, we see these two women. They're important. Hang on to that. If you're a skeptic, please hang on to that. And they see that Jesus is not dead. The tomb is empty. And the empty tomb is proof. Now some people say, well, you know what? Stop. I come because maybe my spouse makes me come, or a parent makes me come, or some such thing. But this is just nonsensical. I have some objections, and I can explain this. There's a rational reason for all of this. Well, let's talk about the most common ones that are thrown out, okay? First one, the disciples overpowered the guards, stole the body, and then ran around claiming he has risen. That's been used. Well, there's a few problems with that. Actually, there's many problems with that. First, the scriptures do not paint the disciples as being very brave. When they're with Jesus during his ministry, at times they are. But right now, where they are, they're huddled up in a house scared to death. But the other problem with this, the idea that these disciples could overpower trained Roman guards, roll back the stone, and then run around, they'd have to hide the body, saying, oh, he's risen, he's risen, he's risen. There's more problems with that too. First of all, they're not going to be able to do this with these two trained Roman guards. But then you have to address the whole issue of what happened to the disciples. Suppose this is the greatest scam in the history of humanity, okay? And some would say, oh yeah, this is a scam. You know, he didn't really rise from the dead. His followers made all of this up. Well, if we walk and we see what happened to his followers, we have to ask ourselves some pretty big questions. Let me ask you a question. How many of you have ever told a lie? Those who did not raise your hand, you just did. And you know that. Come on. Now, when you were a child, this is okay, because some of you are saying, I'm not going to raise my hand because I'm an adult. Okay, so when you were a kid and you lied, and you're faced with consequences or telling the truth, what do? If you're given a choice by your parent, either tell the truth or there are going to be consequences, what do you when you're a kid? Yeah, you're going to tell the truth. I don't want the consequences. All of the disciples, all of them went to their death, martyred, saying, no, we've seen him. We've touched him. We've heard him. He is alive. They would not back down. The only one who was not martyred was John. He was scalded with boiling oil and exiled on a small island called Patmos. You're going to go through any of that if you're covering up. Does that make sense? Someone's going to crack. You might say, okay, well, you know, so whatever. I still don't believe, and I have other objections. And some people, and this one actually has been posited, that everybody went to the wrong tomb. Now, the problem, again, there's multiple problems with this. Going to the wrong tomb. There were two groups of people who had a very profound interest in wanting this talk of he is risen to stop. The Jewish leaders and the Roman authorities. They want this to stop. All they had to do was go say, no, wrong tomb. Sorry, over here, there he is. Believe me, they wanted to produce a body to shut these people up. But there was no body. You say, okay, well, no. There's another objection that I have. And this is a theory that is actually out there. And some call it the swoon theory. The swoon theory says this, that Jesus on the cross really didn't die. He came close to it. They brought him down. And in the cool of this tomb, he resuscitated. Columbo, think with me here. Suppose that were even true, that somehow that he didn't die, but he resuscitated. Okay, he has been beaten to a bloody pulp, whipped, raw nerves exposed. He has been crucified. Spear stuck through his side. So now he's going to get up and push a stone away, overpower guards, walk into town and say, I have overcome death. That's the most illogical thing in the world. You see, the reality is, and we can go on and on and on and on and on with possible objections, but the reality is an empty tomb still bears witness. He has risen. And Jesus' rising from the dead means everything. You see, the resurrection is supremely important to the Christian faith. There are some, which again, this makes no sense, will say, you know, I believe in Jesus. Yes, he may have been the Son of God, but this whole idea of rising from the dead, that's just too much. Paul addresses this thinking, and if you're thinking that way, I want you to hear what he has to say in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 14 and following. Paul says this, and if Christ has not been raised, then our preaching is in vain, and your faith is in vain. We are even found to be misrepresenting God because we testified about God that he raised Christ, whom he did not raise, if it is true that the dead are not raised. For if the dead are not raised, not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile and you are still in your sins. And all of those who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. If in Christ we have hope in this life only, we are of all people most to be pitied. Here's the bottom line. If Jesus did not rise from the dead, you're wasting your time, and so am I. Matter of fact, I have wasted the majority of my adult life talking, researching, telling others about Jesus. You're wasting your life right now by being here. You should be out somewhere else if he did not rise from the dead. But, if he did rise from the dead, That changes everything. As Timothy Keller said something along the lines of this, if Jesus did not rise from the dead, there's no need to listen to him. But if he did rise from the grave, then we must listen to him and obey everything he said. See, here's the deal. And it's been stated, we've stated this in other messages before. Jesus is either of supreme importance or he is of no importance at all. What he cannot be is moderately important. And a lot of people in our culture today, that's who Jesus is for them. Oh yeah, he's someone that I hang out with. Jesus is my homeboy. No, he's not. He's either the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, or he is a dead man worth nothing. And if he is King of Kings and Lord of Lords and risen from the grave, then the only logical response is to surrender our lives to him and say, not my will, but yours. I will take up my cross and follow you. So let's go back to the scene, the women at the tomb. Why is that so important? We miss this because of our Western worldview and our modern worldview. Because there's another theory. Some say, well, you know, some guy just concocted this story and wrote it. Well, if that were the case, and what we could get into this, and you can research it yourself, then we have to deal with all the first century writings of the disciples who wrote about this church who already existed, the explosion of the church. But if we want to look at this, someone wrote it, concocted a story, the angel's instructions are important. Verses 7 and following, he tells the ladies, go quickly and tell his disciples that he has risen from the dead, and behold, he is going before you to Galilee, there you will see him. See, I have told you. In other words, go tell his disciples right now. He has risen from the dead, and Jesus will go before you into Galilee. You will see him there. You have my word. Who does the angel entrust this message to? Women. Some of you are like, well, so? That's really important. That's very important. We'll see why in a second. Verse 8, so the woman, they departed quickly from the tomb with fear and great joy and ran to tell his disciples. There's holy fear intermingled with great joy. And now they believe and they realize he has risen. Everything he said. So they're running to go tell the disciples, the men who are doing what? Hiding. Because they're afraid that what happened to Jesus is going to happen to them. Another surprise, and I love this. Behold, Jesus met them, the women, and said, greetings. And they came up and took hold of his feet and worshiped him. And Jesus said, do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers, hang on to that word, to go to Galilee, and there they will see me. I don't know about you, but I love Jesus' word, how he greets them, greetings. As if he'd just been gone just for, I've been around the block, I'll come back, greetings. No, he's been dead. He appears, greetings. And the women are amazed, and they grab his feet, and they worship him. Absolutely devoted to the Lord Jesus Christ. They see with their own eyes, he is risen. And what does Jesus tell these two women to do? Go tell the disciples. There again, women is important. Now some of you say, why does he keep talking about women? You'll see. The angel entrusts this message to the women. Jesus entrusts this message to the women and says, go tell my brothers. Now, I want to talk real briefly about brothers because I think that's important. An important designation. You see, when Jesus was arrested, all ran and abandoned him. Peter denies him. The men go into hiding. All but John have gone at the cross. John is there with Mary, but these disciples have displayed a profound amount of fear. And they turned their backs and they ran. And if you think if you were on that cross and these men whom you have invested in, these men whom you love, and they've run, and you've heard one you love very deeply, I don't know him. Some of us might say, you know what, go get those guys. Go get them, and I'm going to set them straight. Well, what does Jesus call them? Go get my brothers. Do you see the grace there? kindness, the love, even for those who didn't want to be identified with him. You see, it's true of them, and it's also true for those of us who belong to the Lord Jesus Christ, that he is not ashamed to call us brothers. He loves us. So he tells them to go into Galilee to tell his disciples the good news, and that he's going to meet them there. Now we deal with the women. Now we address why this is a big deal. If someone were just writing a story and trying to concoct a religion, and they wrote this from the first century, boy, did they make every mistake in the book. And I'll tell you why. One, if someone was making something up in the first century, they would have never had women be the witness. In fact, that's actually scandalous in that day and time that they were. You might say, I don't understand why. Let me quote from theologian and historian Andreas Kostenberger. He said this, in the first century, women were not even eligible to testify in a Jewish court of law. Did you catch that? Their testimony did not matter. Josephus, who is a Jewish historian, said that even the witness of multiple women was not acceptable, quote, because of the levity and boldness of their sex. Now, if you're going to be mad at Josephus, not me. Okay? Celsus, the second century critic of Christianity. In other words, he's not a Christian. He mocked the idea of Mary Magdalene as a resurrection witness, referring to her as a hysterical female deluded by sorcery. You see, if you're going to concoct a religion, you would have said, and then the men came, because that would be reliable witnesses and people would believe. It's a theological reminder here. This is so huge. A theological reminder that the kingdom of the Messiah turns the system of the world on its head. And in this culture, Jesus radically is affirming the full dignity of women and the vital value of their witness. Second, it's a powerful apologetic reminder of the historical accuracy of the resurrection accounts. If these were, quote, cleverly devised myths, women would have never been presented as the first witnesses of the risen Christ. Do you catch that? Someone concocting a story would have never done this, but God did. The women are the first witnesses, and nothing is more important in terms of going back and looking as to the reliability of this story. If you're following the sermon series, if you have been here, we have seen over the course of the past several weeks that Jesus made amazing claims about himself. He said that he could forgive sins. He said about himself that he was the only way to have a relationship with the Father. He said that he had authority over life and death. He also claimed that he was divine, the great I am, and he had his story end on a cross, and it would end and would mean nothing if that's where the story ends. None of those claims would be true, but because he rose from the grave, all of those claims are true. I want us to see why. For some of you, you may say, okay, well, I may be able to accept that this happened. I don't understand what this has to do with me. What's the relevance? We'll look at a couple of things I think are very important for us to understand. Philippians 2, 5 and following. Paul writes this, have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who, though he was the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men, and being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name that is above every name, so at the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Here's the relevance. Because he has risen from the grave, he sits at the right hand of God, and he is King of kings and Lord of lords. And the word of God says this, that there is coming a day when every knee will bow and every tongue will confess, you are Lord. But here's the reality. And I need you to please understand this. Yes, there is that day coming when every knee will bow and every tongue will confess. But for some, it'll be too late. You see, the time to make that confession is now. Now. The time to start following Jesus is now. Because it's too late on the other side. And one day, the scripture says, it's appointed for man to die once. And then the judgment. All of us are going to stand before the holy God above all of creation. Some of you are like, yeah, well, that's no big deal. I will say this with all due respect. To be in the presence of the holiness of God will be the most traumatic thing that you will have ever experienced. You're not going to stand before God and blow yourself up and say, I did it my way. You will cry out for mercy. You'll say, Jesus is Lord. But it's going to be too late. The time to respond to Jesus is now. Now. Jesus said, whoever wants to save his life must lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. If you want true life, you give your life to Christ now and you follow him now. You don't wait. You don't put it off. Every person, every knee, from Nero to Hitler to Osama bin Laden to you and me, everyone throughout all history will bow and confess him as Lord. The question is, will it be too late? I pray you respond now. There's another reason this is relevant to us, because Jesus rose from the grave. His victory is our victory. I can't remember now where it ranks. I think it's slipped to number two for some reason. I don't understand that public speaking is still people's greatest fear over death, but death is number two, I guess now. But death. He said, oh, don't want to hear about death. Come on, man. It's Easter and we've got good food to eat and we're in our nice clothes and let's not talk about morbid things. You keep bringing it up. Death. For the Christian, death does not have victory. Death is not victorious over the Christian. Paul said this in 1 Corinthians 15, verses 54 through 57. When the perishable puts on the imperishable and the mortal puts on immortality, then shall come to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Here's the deal. Because Jesus Christ defeated death, he gives that victory to his followers. You see, there's going to come that day. I know when I myself and you yourself, unless Christ returns in our lifetime, I will die. But because of the Lord Jesus Christ, I will walk through that thin membrane, be carried by my Lord and Savior, and death will not hold the victory. I will be in the presence of my King. For those who belong to the Lord Jesus Christ, we can rejoice because death does not win. Jesus has won. His victory is our victory. So today we celebrate because he rose from the grave. He has given us this victory. And he is King of kings and Lord of lords. If we go back to our first text, you see that everything hinges on the resurrection. Everything. The empty tomb bears witness. The explosion of the early church bears witness. The disciples and their disciples and so on and so on. The martyrs bear witness. Transformed lives throughout history bear witness. Lives here today bear witness. He is risen and he is still changing lives today. Because he is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. So now the question for each of us is, how will you respond? How will I respond? Some of us today are saying, you know what? My response is this. I'm ready to go out and eat. I'm ready to go home and eat. I will deal with him later. As if you have the guarantee of later. Others are saying, you know, I kind of want to do things my way. Is there some way that I can follow Christ and still kind of live life on my own terms? You know, kind of hedge my bets. No, Jesus says quite clearly to all of us, take up your cross and follow me. We exchange our life for his life. How are you going to respond to him? I want us to bow our heads. We're going to have a word of prayer. Then we'll have what we call a time of invitation. That time of invitation is an opportunity for each of us here to respond to the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, if you are here today and you have not yet placed your faith and trust in the risen Savior, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, today can be that day. When we stand and sing, I'm going to ask for you to do something very courageous, and that will be to leave where you're seated. There will be people here rejoicing with you. You can come forward. I'll be standing here in the front, and just please tell me. See, I want to follow Jesus. I want to give my life to Jesus. We'll pray. We'll set up a time to meet. You can leave here today a brand new creation because of Jesus. Some of you may be looking for a church home. And you're thinking, you know, I want to plant myself somewhere where we'll learn the scriptures and where we'll be on mission, and we just feel called to plant ourselves here. I'm going to ask for you to please leave where you're seated and just come forward and say, I'd like to join with the church, and we'll set up a time to meet, okay? Others, perhaps you just want to come forward and just pray and worship. Worship the risen Savior. However you need to respond today, I pray that all of us would say, yes, Lord, because he's worthy of that. Our Heavenly Father, I want to thank you for our time today. Lord, we praise you because Jesus Christ is risen from the grave. And because of that, that changes everything in all of human history. Father, I pray that for each of us, that we would respond to Jesus by saying, yes, Lord. And I pray this in his name. Amen.